Deepali is the editor of Energy Explained publication at the Center on Global Energy Policy at Columbia University. Deepali has been an editor for private sector and nonprofit think tanks focused on sustainability and economic issues for more than a decade. Previously, her clients have included Price Waterhouse, Coopers, the Conference Board, Engine Impact, and Visa Economic Empowerment Institute. Her own sustainability writings have appeared in publications such as nextcity.org, strategybusiness.com, Forbes Asia, and MSNBC.com. Deepali is the convener of a series of webinars on climate justice, co-sponsored by several Columbia University schools and centers to bring attention to the importance of bottom-up engagement in shaping policies. Please join me in welcoming Deepali Srivastava.
Thank you, Monica. And thank you, Surya and Sam, for that beautiful music. Hello, everyone. It's really nice to be here today. I am a longtime quasi-member, I guess, of the society, but I've spent most of my time upstairs with the youth program. So it's really nice to be here today with all of you. As Monica mentioned, I have spent several years reading and thinking and writing and editing about climate change and environmental issues. And so what I really wanted to talk about today is, we know that climate change is everyone's crisis, but how many of us really think about who controls the climate change narratives and who produces that knowledge and who shapes the opinion on these topics? And I will share data today. And also the implications of that data, what data tells us, that the knowledge production and influencers in this field tend to be very elite and male. It's a very elite and male-dominated field, the knowledge production and geosciences in general. And that has a certain cost. There's a risk of excluding marginalized voices. And so I think what we all can do about that is sort of just be very critical about the information that comes to us and think about who's sharing those perspectives and where they are coming from and who has a seat at the table. And I'm going to talk a little bit about that. And my inspiration for this is not just my work, but today also happens to be the birth anniversary of India's civil rights icon, Dr. Bhimrao Ambedkar, who is also has a very American story. He studied at Columbia University, got two doctorates from Columbia University, and also really connected with the American civil rights movement. So I'm going to talk about a little bit about how his life and work is actually very inspirational from a climate justice perspective, even though climate change was not in on his radar. He passed away in 1959, but he was an economist and an ecological thinker. I just wanted to give a little bit of a context of, when we talk about energy transition, we need to keep in mind that we need to change our systems in a context where there is still a lot of energy poverty, right? So, energy poverty, and I'm going to talk mostly about India and actually entirely about India and US. Both are big, have large carbon footprints. America historically, India in terms of a growing carbon footprint. But when we think of energy poverty in India, it's still an access issue. 400 million people don't even have access to electricity. In the US, it's an energy insecurity problem. So people have access, and yet about 34 million households in the US are struggling with energy insecurity, meaning that they are not, they're foregoing food, they're foregoing medicines, they are not keeping their homes at the right temperature, healthy temperatures, not using air conditioning because they cannot afford to pay their electricity bills. And the same people who suffer from energy poverty and energy insecurity are also disproportionately impacted by climate change. So they have contributed the least to climate change, and they face the brunt of it, and they have the least ability to cope because they are struggling with poverty and low income. So we need to sort of make a just transition in a world which has never really solved its energy problem to begin with. So this is something which is beginning to get attention. In 2014, when the first IPCC, which is the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change at the UN, wrote its first report on climate change, justice was not even mentioned. Now it's widely recognized that, at least there, acknowledged at that level, that we need this just transition. And yet that has not percolated down, especially, you know, it's happening, that conversation happens at that level. It is, you know, people who are in climate justice movement, you know, Monica and I were talking about it this morning, they get it. But it's still not a mainstream conversation. And this is what is called by Shalanda Baker. She's in the Biden administration in the as an advisor on economic impact and diversity at the USDOE. She's written a terrific book called Revolutionary Power, in which she defines this as climate fundamentalism, which is a narrow focus on advancing climate and clean energy policy while failing to account for justice concerns. And I mean, she also speaks from experience. Her father was working in the oil rigs in Texas and in Port Arthur, and he passed away at the age of 53. So she's a lawyer. And so she's, you know, she speaks both from her knowledge and her personal experience, and I'll talk more about her work later. But why do we, I guess the question is, why is there this kind of climate fundamentalism? And I believe, it's sort of my argument, that it's because there is a lack of diversity in knowledge production in this field. So if you look at the US, only 6% of geoscience doctorates were awarded to American students of underrepresented minorities in 2016. Even though they make up about 31% of the US population. And by geosciences, we mean ocean, atmosphere, and earth sciences. And women of color are particularly excluded. And so why is this happening? And Asmrit Bere, who's a biochemist and a political ecologist, she says that these stories are not being told, and their experiences are not being told because they have been excluded from scientific fields critical to fully understanding and explaining climate impacts. And we see the same trend in India. And I'm not going to go into the data, but I think suffice it to say that India's three most marginalized communities, who are the indigenous people, who are known as Adivasis, the former untouchables of the Indian caste system, who are known as Dalit, and Muslims, many of who are working class, there is an elite Muslim community also, but majority are working class, they are, you know, their representation in higher education, especially science and technology and research, is minimal, and that it's a very elite caste dominated field in India as well. And the same story with media. Energy and environment beat in media is overwhelmingly white, and Indian media in general tends to be, again, the ownership and the anchors and the commentators tend to be very, very elite castes. So this is what Society of Environmental Journalists say. Representation means perspectives, stories, sources, journalists, editors, publishers. And that has not, that entire field of academia and media is not, and especially in geosciences, I think liberal arts and humanities is a different story, a somewhat better story there. It just doesn't have representation of the communities that bear the brunt of climate change. So when we talk of representation as a person of Indian descent, and the first name that would come to our minds would be Dr. Bhimrao Ambedkar, whose birth anniversary is today. He passed away in 1956. He was a lifelong champion of civil rights for oppressed communities of India and a strong believer in representation of marginalized. He had a PhD in economics from Columbia University in 1927 and an honorary degree in 1952. He also got a doctorate in economics from the London School of Economics, and he was also a trained lawyer at Gray's Inn in London. So, I mean, this is probably the most educated Indian of his generation. And he was a chairman of the drafting committee of the Indian Constitution. Now, Dr. Ambedkar was born a former untouchable, a Dalit. So this is also a very American story where someone who, you know, who's dehumanized to that extent goes on to become a person who sort of transforms the trajectory of Indian masses. And he's seen as probably the greatest modern Indian. Because as chairman of the drafting committee, he gave a very affirmative action role to the state. And India actually runs the world's largest affirmative action program for positions in parliament, state legislatures, government jobs, and government-run educational institutions. So the marginalized communities, the former untouchables, the Dalits, and the indigenous, they are protected categories in the constitution, and they are supposed to get representation in government, and they do. However, since the 90s, India has also privatized, and there is no such requirement in the private sector, and private sector, again, tends to be extremely dominated by the elite castes. So that has sort of the privatization has also led to increase in inequalities. And I think perhaps the biggest gains India made in terms of closing the sort of gaps, wealth and income were for a couple of decades after independence, and largely because of government-run affirmative action programs. So I wanted to connect with the music of today, and also just why is this important to us here in New York. So this on the left here is, I don't know how much you can see, I guess I made it really small. But this is the Indian caste system, and at the top are the Brahmins, who used to be the priests and now are sort of the controllers of the knowledge industries, academia and media and so on. Then you have the Kshatriyas, who are the warrior caste, and the Vaishyas, who are the traders and who are the billionaires in the, so that's the merchant community. And as India, you know, Indian economy is the darling of the world now, but the people who have made the most gains are these billionaire capitalists. And then you have the Dalits and the Adivasis, who are the former untouchables at the bottom. So when Dr. MLK had gone to India in 1965, he went to a school which was largely for Dalit children. And the principal of that school introduced him as an untouchable of America. And so Dr. MLK says that he writes that he was, really peeved by that. But then he's been invited by the prime minister. He's kind of a rock star in India. People are, he considers Gandhi his role model. People are very welcoming of him, but he's called an untouchable. But then he says when he starts thinking about it, he actually realizes when he thinks of the 20 million of his brothers and sisters who are living in unendurable conditions in the slums of our big cities with improper facilities, I said to myself, yes, I am an untouchable. And so I've talked about, why that there is this sort of lack of representation in sciences, especially earth sciences. Why has it evolved in this way is the question, right? Why are these communities sort of facing these barriers and so much exclusion? And there are scholars and historians whose perspective is that it's because geosciences has sort of evolved to support colonialism. So the study of natural resources and land has been very much limited to the study of what land can produce or what our resources can produce for profit motive. And it's not really focused at all in terms of the relationship of land and the environment with the people who are displaced. And the people who are displaced by colonialism are, you know, largely invisibilized or considered vastly inferior. So there's a way in which science has evolved, earth sciences, which has supported basically the economic model. And the economic model is putting land to productive use and profit making. But this is not just an issue of sort of Western dominance of the world. Amitav Ghosh, who is a historian and an environmentalist, he says what we are seeing in India and in other parts of Asia is the wholesale adoption of settler colonial practices by political and economic elites. So this is pretty much the prevailing system of economics, where you know there are these elites. In India, it plays out through the caste system, here, you know, by race and ethnicity. And there are, in recent times, a lot of books that have been written about sort of the parallels between US and India in terms of the hierarchies, social hierarchies of the societies. Coming back to Dr. Ambedkar and environmental justice and climate justice, when we think about our societies where there is this kind of inequality where people's status in society is determined by their, you know, birth. And then from the time they are born, there are so many obstacles to advancing. That kind of imbalance in power has a lot to do with our climate crisis. And without addressing that balance, we will not secure a safe and just future for all. And Dr. Ambedkar, more than 100 years ago, was writing things without sort of, you know, facing this ecological crisis, which sort of provides an important and useful framework for understanding how we can begin to address this from a climate justice perspective. So three things that I've learned from Dr. Ambedkar and reading his work as an economist and an ecological thinker is that green is not necessarily just. Any kind of economic transition should be centered on the rights of the working class and the marginalized. And for natural resources, what's needed are bottom-up models of governance. So I'm just going to talk about each of these three. And in fact, I just wrote an article on this in an independent Indian publication, and my dad read it, and he said, oh, this is an eye-opener. So I feel like if I'm even able to change or open up a few minds of, among my family and friends, I feel like it's a contribution. Just because Ambedkar is recognized in a certain way in India, but people don't think of him as an economist and an ecological thinker because of the control of narratives. In a way, he was such an insurgent thinker that he was shut out of those fields. So when he says green is not necessary, or when I say that I learned from him that green is not necessarily just, Ambedkar wrote a cult classic. He didn't even write it. It was a speech he was invited to give, and the speech was canceled. It was kind of like what would be equivalent of a banned book. Because when people got an advanced copy of the speech, they were sort of shocked and they didn't think they could give him that platform. It's called Annihilation of Caste. It's sort of he's thinking like an abolitionist. Like you have to truly like dismantle the system if you want the society to make progress. So he really sort of attacks the heart and the root causes of inequalities in Hindu society. And he says that he calls upon Hindus to for annihilation of caste. And there he says in that book that that caste system is a division of laborers and not merely a division of labor. So the society, I mean, he talks about the way the society is segregated in terms of the extraction of labor and distribution of resources. So he has that kind of insight then of inequalities and what that means for economic structures. And interestingly, the more well-known Indian, Mohandas Gandhi, he took offense at that book. And then Ambedkar and Gandhi engaged in a very public ideological clash because Gandhi had his idea of spirituality and Hinduism, and he was sort of, he was respectful of Ambedkar, but he always called him the learned doctor, but he was offended by the book, and so they both exchanged letters, and those letters are widely read in India, and it's a very sort of interesting and poignant story of modern India where these two great men are in this kind of ideological confrontation. But when you see this kind of economic structures that Ambedkar talked about then, I mean, we see that in our climate and our energy transition, right? The entire electrification and battery economy, it's built on minerals, lithium mining and cobalt mining. And if we start looking into, the conditions of the people who are working for, I mean, I think the worst and the most horrifying example of that is cobalt mining in Congo, and it really sort of, if these are things that are still not well known, but as we think about it and when we find out about it, it really gives pause. Is our electrification and the whole battery economy of the people like us really going to be built on the extraction of labor of people who work in absolutely horrifying conditions in Congo? Then the other piece of what we can learn from Ambedkar is that, so when you think about how labor is extracted for our economic structures, then any kind of an economic transition really needs to be centered on workers' rights and protections. So he thought about it in two ways, and he was actually a labor minister in the British government before India was independent, at a time when the British had started including Indians in, there was some representation of Indians. So he was a labor minister, and he introduced any number of bills which would look very much like very, very progressive democratic policies of the US right now. He was talking about, and this is late 1930s and early 1940s, so he was talking about workmen's compensation, leisure for workers, and maternal benefits. He was also kind of a feminist. He wanted contraceptives for women, which scandalized people because he saw women workers in the mines. He actually went down to mines and inspected them. Social security protections, all sorts of, and so some were successful, some were not. But he did successfully sort of get a few of those legislations in the British government. And then he had this vision for agriculture, which is very much like what would be considered collective farming or cooperatives. So he was anti-communism too. He was anti-capitalist, anti-communism. He had his own sort of vision. And this idea of collective farming, because he saw India has, and still has to this day, so many millions of small subsistence farmers. So, how do you get scale without a corporate big sort of entity exploiting that through the idea of cooperatives? And actually, incidentally, India's most prosperous state in the south, Kerala, has this model for women, and it's very successful, and the government has supported it, and it's very socially acceptable there for Dalit women to be sort of owners in cooperatives. And that's kind of a big sort of transformational thing in that society. So it's achievable. His vision is not utopian. He was a very practical man. And he says that for ours is a battle not for wealth or for power. It's a battle for freedom. It's the battle for reclamation of human personality. So, Ambedkar is quoted a lot because almost everything he says, he thought and he said a lot. He worked, he was a very busy man. But he has such insight and foresight in everything he says that he is actually, one of the probably the most widely quoted Indians. And the third thing, and I've talked about the models for inclusion of marginalized women, and he sort of had a vision for environmental democracy in which resources are sort of controlled by the people who have been excluded. And he, in 1927, he led a civil rights, sort of civil disobedience movement and marched to a public tank, which legally Dalits had a right to drink water, but they were still not allowed to drink water from it. And so, African Americans have sort of written about that and connecting it with how water remains also. It's almost like a metaphor for the environmental crisis that faces the marginalized in the US too, right? Like think, you know, Flint, Michigan, and, you know, so clean drinking water is, again, something that is at the heart of our climate crisis. And we say it's an existential issue, but for the people who are at the on the fringes and margins of society, it has always been an existential crisis. So Ambedkar leads this march to drink water, and he's also a man who follows the law and very much a civil disobedience type of person. I mean, no, never would he ever, do anything sort of use violence as a means to an end. And the speech he gives there, and there are women who are marching with him in 1927, and the speech he gives there is, unity is meaningless without the accompaniment of women. Education is fruitless without educated women, and agitation is incomplete without the strength of women. So this is a man who's an economist, a lawyer, a civil rights icon, and he's a feminist. And he is also a spiritual leader. So Ambedkar, one of the last things he did before he passed away, he passes away in 1959. In 1956, he left Hinduism and he became a Buddhist in a very public ceremony. And I think about 400,000 Dalits converted with him. And he had announced his intention of leaving the Hindu fold 20 years ago, but it took him this long to think about what path he should embrace. And so he interpreted Buddhism, and he wrote about that in the book, The Buddha and His Dharma. And in that book, he also, he views Buddhism as a sort of a social reform and against the sort of the Brahmanical control of Hindu society. But there's so much more to that. And one of those things is his, that comes across in his book, is his sort of eco-spirituality and how he's looking at the planet. And he says, love is not enough. What is required is maitri. It is wider than love. It means fellowship, not merely with human beings, but with all living beings. It is not confined to human beings. Is not such maitri necessary? So he is interpreting the Buddha as someone who believed in the fellowship of all living beings and not just among human beings, which again is very similar to the way the, you know, Pope Francis has talked about the environmental crisis and you know, as sort of what are our shared commons and what is, the cry of the poor and the cry of the earth being mingled. So Ambedkar is writing that in 1957. And so when we think about, Ambedkar's wisdom, and all of his writings are publicly available online and thanks to the archivists, I mean, he didn't get any kind of state support. It's just his community, and then now he's being widely studied by scholars in India and in the US. But when we think about what we learn from him, I think that's when the narrative, the dominant narrative of climate fundamentalism can kind of, start shifting, and you see that Ambedkar with his vision would have probably seen climate justice as an issue of caste justice, or within an US context as a civil rights justice issue. And speaking of civil rights, when Ambedkar was studying at Columbia University, he corresponded with W.E.B. Du Bois, and he became aware that Du Bois was involved in some kind of effort at the UN to see Black Americans as a minority. And Ambedkar wanted the same for Dalits in India, so he wrote a letter to Du Bois, which was found only a few years ago in the archives of Du Bois, where he says, I want to find out, learn more about this. And so Du Bois writes back to him in 1946, October, I think, and he says, I am very familiar with the challenges of the untouchables of India. So that's all we know about their correspondence. There are people who want to find out more about whether, you know, there was anything more to it or not. It's not yet known. So when we think of climate justice as a civil rights issue or a caste justice issue, then we know that we are not going to arrive at it by accident. This has to be very intentional in our policies. And it is sort of becoming, I mean, there are people who are advising President Biden, their advisors now, how much of that advice actually translates into policy and implementation is an open question. But some of these ideas are this idea of, there's Ben Beachy, he's one of the advisors to White House on this issue, and he talks about a new national institution where the impacted communities are as much a part of the conversation and setting goals and targets based on their experiences and their knowledge as, you know, any economist or technocrat or, you know, the people who are the decision makers. And the UK has something like that in their national climate law, where they have carbon budgets every few years, and then they are tracking progress, and inclusion is part of it. And then Shalanda Baker, who I mentioned, she's written this book, Revolutionary Power, which is kind of her analysis of the power grid and utilities, that whole system of the US. And she studied California and Hawaii, and she's come up with a whole lot of ideas about how to reform public utilities, make them much more sort of cooperative, less investor owned. Also, how to shift to distributed power, like mini grids, and decentralize, like, you know, rooftop solar, and how to make that more accessible or prioritize access to people who are suffering from energy insecurity. So green loans for the people who don't have good credit, for example. So there are these ideas, they are out there. One of the things about the US which is different from Europe is that Europe taxes the polluters through carbon tax. US is giving incentives to big business basically through Inflation Reduction Act. So if you know, the incentives, whether it's subsidies or tax breaks and things like that, so which is all good, but you know, it is incentives for the companies. And so then without integrating equity by design, it is very possible that, you know, there's a very high risk of sort of switching off fossil fuels and switching on to renewables without really addressing the systemic imbalances and which got us to this point to begin with. And that's why I think it's important to keep thinking about, you know, what we learned from Ambedkar, what we learned from Dr. MLK, and so on. I think this is it. I did have one more slide. Oh, yeah. So, am I doing okay for time? Okay. And so this is the last thing I wanted to say. There are people who are working in this field and who have a lot of ideas that I shared. So, but I just wanted, if anybody is curious to find out more, I just put some books and movie recommendations here. But Dr. Ambedkar's, like I said, all of his writings and speeches are actually available on this website, baws.in. He's known as Baba Sahab, which means our old esteemed father figure. So it stands for Dr. Baba Sahab Ambedkar's writings and speeches. And I'll just give him the last word. History shows that where ethics and economics come in conflict, victory is always with economics. Vested interests have never been known to have willingly divested themselves unless there was sufficient force to compel them. So we are really at this moment of transition. And as Ambedkar says, vested interest will not willingly divest, because history shows that economics tends to win unless it is forced by ethics to change. And I think we can all think about how we can be part of that force to compel change. That's all I have. I had one more thing to say, but this will be short. I just wanted to share that today, because it's Dr. Ambedkar's birthday, one of a very popular sort of greeting and salutation is literally translates to victory to Bhim, and it is Jai Bhim. So I just want to conclude with Jai Bhim.
Thank you so much.
Okay.
Check, check.
So we only have time for a few questions because we have to have lunch and they have to prepare the room for the play this afternoon. But Maggie's going to come around with a microphone.
Just raise your hand, Chuck.
Was the original basis for the caste system religious or economic?
Oh, I mean, I'm not a scholar of religion, but it came, it is supposed to be about 2,000 years ago, and India has had waves of migration, and it came with and this is very contested. I mean, the right wing in India would explode if they were, you know, they do. But I mean, it has been historically and genetically and linguistically shown that the caste system was brought by the Indo-Aryans. So there was a big wave of, and that is sort of the connection between the Western right and the Hindu right, where they both sort of see their roots as the same Aryan culture. And so in their Vedic literature, what they brought to India, and their literature was mostly oral, but recited through Brahminical verses, that was the origin of the sort of the hierarchy of the caste system.
With the advent of higher education and increase in social mobility, technology in India, such as institutions of greater learning, the Indian Institute of Technology, which is probably one of the prestigious, do you see the caste system improving due to this type of social economic mobility through education?
Yeah, I think India truly made gains through the program of affirmative action, and the IITs that you mentioned are government-run programs. So yes, they did have affirmative action, but despite that, the representation is pretty small in sciences. I think there's more of that in the public liberal arts universities, where there is a larger presence of especially Dalit scholars, and they've truly sort of, they're game changers in knowledge production in India, and some of them are here now at Harvard, at Columbia, and they have a very different voice from what historically the Indian diaspora, which tends to be very so-called upper caste, represented in the world. And so there is absolutely, both in India as well as globally, there is a very strong presence of especially Dalit scholars. But as I had mentioned earlier, India, this is only in government institutions, and India has privatized a lot, and there is no such, no programs of inclusion like this, which are required constitutionally. So privatization has really sort of, it has been a setback from an equality and inclusion perspective.
We have time for one more question. Ken?
We had a dialogue with Joe Schumann and another climate-involved person, and it seemed to be the result of that conversation was that the outlook was very pessimistic, okay? We have to have more catastrophes in the world, and when there is more catastrophes, that will pressure people to do more, to go over to clean energy, but it doesn't look promising because of what you said. The fossil fuel industry has too much power, and that's going to be a problem. Yeah, and I don't see how we can move forward. Like, we've had the forest fires last year. Remember the forest fires? And, well, I don't know what we're going to have this year. Flooding, maybe. We have this drought in the Southwest. and our water level is going down, the aquifers are going down. So this is going to create some kind of crisis. It's already creating crises. And our response to these crises is vital to have that we have a positive effect on it, to it. But you know, the crisis is going to come.
Yeah, I agree. But I mean, the crisis is already here. Okay, thank you very much for having me.